My name's Don Reinertsen. I'm not going to talk about my background. I'll let the material speak for itself here. What I want to talk about is some of the logical principles behind making flow work in processes. And my guess is, I haven't been at the previous FlowCon, but I think we have a mix of people who are pretty sophisticated and people who are probably just starting with it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit on some things that are going to be obvious for you experienced people, and then I'm also going to hit on some more sophisticated concepts. So I'm going to try to give you all something at least that you can get out of the presentation. What I've decided to talk about are some of the key underlying mechanisms that create flow in processes. And it independent of whether I'm talking about a manufacturing process or a product development process and things, there is math that ends up applying to both. So I want to talk a little bit about the concept of queuing in processes. I want to talk about the idea of batch size reduction. I want to talk about the importance of fast feedback loops in processes and why that, because the small batch size permits the faster feedback, why would we be interested in the faster feedback? And then I want to talk about the concept of congestion control in processes, and I'll sort of show you a little bit of that in sort of as much as I can get into. And my intent is hopefully to convince you that there are more advanced ideas out there that you can end up using, much more advanced ideas than the ideas that appear in lean manufacturing and things. And you just need to look in the right places for some of the ideas. If you showed an internet protocol engineer the Toyota production system, they would look at it and say, I recognize that. That's a tail-dropping FIFO queue. That's what we used on the internet 40 years ago. There are obvious reasons why that is not a good flow control strategy, why we have evolved TCP/IP several generations beyond that. But if you limit yourself to the ideas of manufacturing, you're using a set of ideas that is working in a domain of very homogeneous, repetitive flow, which is very different than what you see in product development. So let's start with queuing. The classic queuing system you're all familiar with is a traffic at rush hour on a crowded highway. If I took a four-lane highway and I removed one lane of capacity at rush hour, that represents 25% of the capacity. What will happen to the cycle time on that highway if you remove 25% of capacity? Will cycle time increase by 25%? No. You'll double cycle time on a highway if you remove a lane of capacity at rush hour. Intuitively, you understand queuing systems if you've ever been in traffic at rush hour, because you realize that changes in loading produce a nonlinear impact, and the nonlinearity depends on the level of capacity utilization. And that is precisely what real queuing theory would show you. This is a queuing curve for what is known as an MM1 infinite queue. It's a standard queuing curve. All other queuing curves look very similar to it, but it has nice closed form solutions. The particular solution for this one is the length of the queue is going to be rho squared over 1 minus rho. Rho is the symbol we use for capacity utilization. If you look at that formula, you should recognize the thing goes to infinity when you run at 100% utilization. It is really dangerous to operate stochastic systems at close to 100% utilization. But that is precisely what we do in a lot of product development processes, because the mental models that we're using are deterministic models. Deterministic models overload when you reach 100% utilization. Queues are doubling roughly every time you have the distance to the right-hand axis in a process. So if you recognize you have queues in a development process, you might ask, where on that curve do I want to operate? So let's say you had a test area and you have a choice between operating at 90% utilization with a 4-week queue or at 80% utilization with a 2-week queue. What would be the better choice? You could look at the world of lean manufacturing and they would tell you just eliminate waste. Well, you would know that 2 weeks of extra queue time is waste, and you'd know 10 percentage points of utilization is waste, but one waste goes up when the other waste goes down. You can't compare 2 weeks of cycle time to 10 percentage points of utilization because they are in different units of measure. You've got to get them into the same unit of measure. Whenever you have a problem with more than one moving part, you need to bring those parts into the same unit of measure. And that's how you start dealing with these queuing problems. So if you look at queuing problems showing up in development processes, the economics of it are driven by two factors. One is the level of capacity utilization you're using, and the other is the cost of the queue you've created in the process. So most people in the world only see this green line here, the capacity utilization. And because they're unaware of the red line, the cost of the queue, they think that the way I minimize total cost is I operate with no excess capacity in the process. They think they should be operating down there. Now, if you are aware of the size of queues in your process and you have a way of converting the size of the queue into a cost number, then you can start making the optimization between capacity and queue size in a process. The nice thing is it's a very pleasant optimization to make because it's a flat-bottomed U-curve and you don't have to have the right number. You get anywhere close to the right number and you're going to end up having good economics. The problem is, when I was teaching classes at Caltech, executive courses there, for 14 years, the average development organization that was there was loading to 98.5% utilization. It was way higher on the queuing curve. And the reason we make mistakes about having bigger queues than we should in development processes is because in manufacturing, the queue is physical objects and we can see the queue. In manufacturing, we carry the queue on the balance sheet as a cost item. In development, our queues are information, which is intrinsically invisible. We don't see the queues, but they're also financially invisible because we don't carry them on our balance sheet. But if you have a cost of delay and if you know the size of the queues, you can start approaching this as an economic trade-off. Now, and what percent of the people know the cost of delay and the size of the queues? 98% of product developers are not measuring the size of queues in their process. About 15% of product developers know the cost of delay. So about 1% of the world is equipped to make this trade-off in a rational way. Now, if you look deeper at the queuing curve, the queue depends also on the level of variability. And I don't want you to memorize this formula or anything like that, but I want to just sort of make a point here. For more complex queues with different arrival time distributions and things like that, we typically use heavy traffic approximations. We break them into two components, one associated with utilization, one associated with variation and things. Variation, we use the coefficient of variation, which is a classic statistical term. It's a dimensionless measure of the variability of a distribution. The thing I want to point out here is that the utilization factor is geometric, the variation factor is linear. So mathematically, your weapon of choice for reducing queues in a development process is going to be capacity utilization. It has more mathematical leverage than reducing variation does in the process. The second point I would make about this is there are two variations we are concerned about. One is the service time variation. The other is the arrival time variation going into the queue. Those of you who are Goldratt fans, Goldratt says you can never accelerate flow through a process unless you end up altering the capacity of the bottleneck. Real queuing theory says something very different. Real queuing theory says you can work on the process immediately preceding the bottleneck and reduce the arrival time variation and improve the cycle time in your process. So you really have two choices, not one, if you're trying to improve cycle time. Now, second thing I want to talk about is batch size reduction. Batch size reduction is one of the great keys to reducing queues. Batch size reduction is, again, an economic trade-off. This chart, what I'm doing is, it's always a trade-off between transaction cost and holding cost, the blue line being the holding cost, the red being the transaction cost. Imagine that I said, I'm unhappy with going to the grocery store very often. We eat a lot of eggs during the year. I think I should buy a whole year's supply of eggs in one batch to reduce the number of times I go to the grocery store. So there I would be on this side of the curve. I'd have a very high holding cost, but I would have a low transaction cost. And then I read a book about lean, and I discovered that I should be focusing on one-piece flow. So I said, from now on, we're going to run a lean kitchen in our household. We're going to buy an egg every time we eat an egg. Buy an egg, eat an egg, buy an egg, eat an egg. Then we will be optimally running our process. Well, obviously, what would happen is I'd be on this side of the curve where my transaction cost would be, I'd be making lots of trips to the grocery store, but I would have a low holding cost. Now, this concept of economic lot size is not a new-to-the-world concept. Over 100 years ago, the first article on this was written. A guy by the name of Ford Harris said, there are not many men who understand the theory underlying the economic size of lots. And so a knowledge of it should be of considerable value. Now, that was not because in 1913 all the women understood this and only the men had problems with it. Today, we would end up saying not many men understand the issue and not many women understand the issue. Because it's an economic trade-off between the two. You'll see that's the same type of curve that I had there. If you dig a little deeper into the issue, the way you get economic lot size, it's just, sort of high school calculus that you're using. You have a total cost equation. You end up finding the minimum by setting the derivative equal to zero, and then you solve for what the optimum lot size is within the process. The interesting thing occurs when you end up saying, what would happen to total cost if I ended up using the optimum lot size? So I'll just plug in this into that equation, and you see your total cost is defined by this formula. Now, the thing I want to point out here is that total cost is dependent on the fixed cost, the transaction cost per batch. So when you end up driving down transaction costs to enable smaller batch sizes in your process, you're getting two factors occurring. One is you're shifting where the optimum batch size is to a smaller optimum batch size, but at the same time, you're lowering the total cost of your process. So when people ask, people would ask the Japanese, why are you reducing batch size and things? And they say, oh, well, we just have faith. We have faith that batch size reduction is good because we have insight on the thing. You can reach the same conclusion with math as you can reach with faith, that reducing batch size ends up paying for itself if you understand the economics of batch size. Okay, and this is all I've done is graphed this. I've taken two different transaction costs. The blue is the old one, the magenta is the new one. So I've shifted down the transaction cost curve, and what happens to the total cost curve, A, is the minimum moves to the left, so it enables a smaller batch size. Second thing that happens is the minimum shifts downward. You make more money when you end up having smaller batch sizes in the process. Okay, fast feedback. All of you should, I hope, be familiar with cumulative flow diagrams and how they work and why you would want to use them to manage flow in processes. Here I've drawn sort of a simple cumulative flow diagram. So this is me arriving at Heathrow Airport. This represents the arrival line of a queue. This is the departure line of a queue. So people are arriving at a constant rate. People are departing at a constant rate. Horizontal distance is constant. That means the wait time is constant in this process. The vertical distance here is constant. The queue size is constant. At time 21, a plane with 400 passengers ends up arriving. What happens when you have that spike in the arrival rate? The queue size goes up to 500. If you are monitoring queue size by time 22, you know you have a problem. If you're monitoring cycle time in this process, the first job that ends up experiencing a double, the original cycle time is 10, first time that job that experiences a doubling of cycle time is the one that departs at time 41. You wait 20 units of time before you get alerted if you're measuring cycle time. You wait 1 unit of time before you get alerted if you're measuring queue size. So queue size is always a leading indicator of future cycle time problems in the process. That's why I think all of you are sort of smart enough to understand the idea that you measure queue size in processes to control processes. You don't measure flow time, cycle times in processes, because that's a lagging indicator. Now, the point I want to make here is actually, what happens if I wait a long time to respond to the change in queues? So let's go back to the traffic analogy I was giving you. If a car breaks down on the highway for 15 minutes, are you going to have 15 minutes of additional cycle time at rush hour? No. You might see an hour of extra cycle time if the car breaks down for 15 minutes. Because you build a queue on a highway much faster than you can shrink the queue in the process. If I can respond quickly to this, let's say I'm measuring queue size and I respond quickly, and I compare that to responding slowly, this red shaded area is the savings that I get with a quick response, because horizontal axis is time, vertical axis is quantity. So the number of passenger minutes of extra delay I get is that red shaded area. Now, the point I want to make is that I am adding an identical amount of capacity whether I add it early or late. It costs me no more to add capacity quickly when I end up seeing a queue emerge in a process and things. It produces savings, but it does not produce additional cost. So the faster you can make your loop closure times in processes in terms of responding to emergent queues, and variability will guarantee that you have emergent queues in your process, the more money you make by not letting that queue persist. Letting queues persist for a period of time is just absolutely pure waste in a process. Now, let me get into the last topic with this congestion control, and this I'm spending a little more time on. I could talk about congestion control on the internet, but not as quickly as I can talk about congestion control in traffic. So I've chosen traffic as the example I want to talk about. We measure traffic flow in vehicles per hour. Typically, that is decomposed into two factors, speed and density. How many miles per hour is the flow? What is the density of the flow in the process? We make a very careful, you know, you see people in product development using the term throughput, and I'll ask them, what do you mean by throughput? Do you mean the throughput rate in the process, the vehicles per hour, or do you mean the number of vehicles that go? And they have no clue what they're talking about. We don't have that problem in traffic flow. When we talk about traffic flow, it is a rate, and it's vehicles per hour. Back in 1934, a traffic engineer by the name of Bruce Greenshields ended up collecting data and saying, how does the amount of cars that move down the highway vary with the speed on that highway? he found that the density dropped linearly with speed. The vehicles were spaced further apart at higher speeds. When you multiply speed by density, you get this green shields curve, which there is a peak throughput point on a highway. It is not at maximum occupancy that you get the peak throughput. It is not at maximum speed you get the peak throughput. It's a trade-off between speed and occupancy. Now, the interesting thing about that is if you start looking at the left-hand side of the curve and the right-hand side of the curve, the feedback loops are intrinsically stable on the right side of the curve, and they are unstable on the left side of the curve and things. So what will happen, when Greenshields collected data, he got very few sample points on the left side of the curve, because on the left side of the curve, if your speed starts slowing, what it does is it drops throughput. You're then clearing fewer cars off that highway, which will increase the density, and that causes speed to slow even more. So it's regenerative on the left-hand side of the curve. Now, what is the implication when you're dealing with a system where you end up being unstable on one side of the curve? The answer is you don't operate at the peak throughput point. Is that you? If you move to the knee of the curve, you end up gaining a lot of stability for very small reduction in throughput. Those of you familiar with the internet would know this is exactly how we approach the issue of offered load on the internet. What we do is we operate on the knee of the throughput curve because we don't want to operate close to that point where we will go into congestion collapse because of the way the feedback loops function in the process. Now, what sort of things could we learn from transportation networks? One is maximum flow doesn't occur at either maximum speed or maximum occupancy. Having very high occupancy is a huge mistake. Optimization requires a trade-off between those two factors. The flow is unstable when the occupancy exceeds the optimum level within the process. And I know you guys are primarily software engineers, not mechanical engineers, but this is very similar, isomorphic, with the problem of the transition between laminar and turbulent flow in fluid mechanics and things. You start losing feedback loops, stability, damping within a system, and you transition to turbulent flow within a process. Fast responses are critical because the queues grow faster than they shrink. We should exploit both provisioning and active congestion management. We do not size our highway systems to handle the peak demand. We don't say, we know there are going to be accidents, therefore the highway needs to be big enough to permit flow even in the presence of accidents. What we do is we size the highways, but we react very quickly at rush hour when we get a car breaking down in the highway system. We combine the active management with the advanced planning. Smoothing flow through the bottlenecks raises throughputs. I was mentioning that when I was showing you that queuing curve. When we transition a highway from four lanes down to three lanes, we do that over about a 2 mile stretch of road. We don't do it over 200 feet worth of road. Why do we do that? Because if we transition too rapidly, we have turbulent flow hitting the bottleneck. If turbulent flow hits the bottleneck, it reduces the throughput within the process. So in a highway system, we channelize the flow prior to the restriction and things to get smooth flow, and that improves the number of cars we can move through a bottleneck. It's exploiting exactly that equation I was showing you on that queuing curve. We should add capacity margins in zones of high variation. I have a long pipeline. I want to end up adding capacity, but I only want to add it in the smart places. Where are the smart places to add capacity? On a highway system, I might end up having a highway going up to Lake Tahoe. Some of it is on level ground. Some of it is on hills that are very steep. Where am I going to see the greatest variation in the speed of the vehicles? On a steep hill or on level ground? On a steep hill. So where do we put the extra channel capacity on a highway? We put the three lanes on the steep hills where the speed of trucks and cars can be very different from one another. We don't put the extra lane capacity in the section of the system that has low variation in it. Adaptive controls will aid flow. All of you have probably been in situations where you're waiting at a red light for, there's a green light on a cross street and you're sitting at a red light, but the green light is serving no cars because there's nobody waiting to cross that street. That is just wasting capacity when you end up not adapting to the conditions. Cues produce spontaneous variation within the process. You have probably seen that. You get this accordioning of flow when the flow starts slowing down. That is not a condition that is present when the flow is proceeding smoothly. Lane changing is actually a complicated issue. Lane changing in front of a bottleneck where you end up introducing turbulence in the flow is a bad idea. But lane changing in other sections on a highway system produce an effect called variability pooling, which will actually improve your throughput of the system. Queue control improves with scale. Scheduling is more difficult with scale. Roughly, if I had to put numbers on it, scheduling problems, let's say I wanted to move one car to downtown Los Angeles at rush hour. I could come up with a schedule to do that. If I want to move a million cars to downtown Los Angeles at rush hour using schedules, that problem will be a trillion times harder, roughly n squared problem when you start trying to schedule lots of things at once. The interesting thing about queues is the larger the queue becomes, the problem becomes smaller as a square root of n type. So the bigger the queue becomes, the more it starts displaying its statistical behavior. So managing queues is far more suited to an environment of having lots of small batches in it than using scheduling-based techniques. We can make fast, effective adjustments by combining decentralized control and centralized information. Any of you have ever been in Paris on the periphery, the ring road around Paris, what you'll see is they give you information on here's how long it will take you to get to the next port, the next exit point on the periphery. Truly useful information because you then decide whether you want to get off the periphery and use surface streets or not. In the U.S. in some places, we give much more useful information. We give you, this is the distance to the next exit. And because distance changes very infrequently, we don't have to change our signs very often and things like that. But it's not really useful information. Time to the next exit is much more useful. Decentralized actors can act very well in the presence of valid centralized information. Okay, so some general takeaways from this. One is both capacity and queues cost money. If you're going to try to make a decent trade-off between capacity and queues, you want to quantify the economics of the trade-off. One of the things you need to know to be able to do that is cost of delay. So those of you been exposed to a scaled agile framework and things like that, you'll see how much importance Dean Leffingwell places on techniques like weighted shortest job first scheduling aren't even possible if you don't know cost of delay. Exploit the flat bottom of the U curve. You don't need to get perfect answers to be able to answer these questions. I always recommend people reduce batch size before they end up adding capacity in processes. You enable small batches by driving down transaction costs. Now, I didn't dwell on it when I hit the formula there, but if you reduce the transaction cost by a factor of 100, the optimum batch size drops by a factor of 10 because it's a square root function on the thing. So if you're targeting to get a significant reduction in batch size, you're going to be looking at making a major reduction in transaction cost to enable the small batches. Transaction cost reduction usually pays for itself. I talked about that issue. Monitor queues instead of cycle time because queues are leading indicator of cycle time problems. react quickly to expanding cues. Design your process to tolerate variability. The reason things like the internet and traffic flow systems are interesting is because we are not using the approach on a traffic system of saying, if we could make all the drivers predictable, we could achieve flow. Toyota production system, techniques like Six Sigma, make the assumption that you can solve the problem by reducing the variability and things. You cannot innovate in product development unless you introduce variability. So you need to look to models of the world where people have not assumed they can make the variability go away. On the internet, we don't assume we can make people send messages when we want them to send messages. We don't assume we can control the size of the files that they transmit. Telecommunication systems, we don't assume we can make phone calls occur when we want them. On traffic systems, we don't assume that we can make the drivers predictable. So look to systems like that to see how people are designing systems that function in the presence of variability. And then, even though we design the system to operate under variability, we need to put in place mechanisms that allow us to compensate for the buildup of variability within the process. We want to both plan ahead in the design of our system, but we also want to have operating tactics that allow us to deal with the variability we're going to see. Otherwise, we would have to massively oversize our systems. And then finally, just, you know, look beyond the ideas of manufacturing. Ideas of manufacturing, great starting point if you want to start working on some of these problems, because they have good techniques for dealing with predictable repetitive flows. But there's a whole lot more out there than the ideas of manufacturing that you can tap into. And interestingly, so many of the great ideas are stuff that people in the software world have been exposed to for year after year. Operating system design is all about non-homogeneous flows. Scheduling and prioritization is very common in operating system design. Internet is all about controlling congestion and dealing with variability and link outages that occur at unpredictable times. So you got lots of patterns that you can exploit. And then finally, these are the books. I think the only reason you might be in the room is you're probably aware of the last book. Last book is the most difficult. There's a guy in Sweden who tweeted a nice tweet about it that I put up there. He said it was Torbjorn Gullibring, and he said, it's wonderful and dense, filling and satisfying even in small bites like fine cheese. I don't know whether it's a substitute for fine cheese, but it is not a book you're going to read through very well. One guy told me, I read through it in an hour and I got nothing out of it. So yeah, I won't say you can't read through it quickly, but you'll get more out of it if you don't try to read through it very quickly.